had the privilege. I mean, remember the story of Black Hawk Down? You guys remember that story? Let me know that story. Black Hawk Down. Let me know that story. In 1983 in Mogadishu, Somalia, we had a situation. It was the 80s. I don't know, a while back. But what ended up happening is we were trying to use our military to shut down a warlord in the area and in Mogadishu, Somalia. And one of our helicopters got shot down by an RPG, rocket propelled grenade. And the Delta Force that was there, these special forces operators, didn't want to, they were dragging the dead body of one of the pilots through the streets trying to make a big deal about the fact that they had killed the guy. Well, that really made the U.S. military mad. So they sent in the Delta Force to try to get the other body of the dead pilot protected. Well, this whole process got worse and worse because we weren't really committed to the process. We were trying to do it really surgically. Least number of people possible. The problem is these guys were armed to the teeth. So we get into this street battle with these guys, and long story short, we end up having to protect the body of the dead pilot for 18 hours. Another helicopter gets shot down. I mean, it turns into a major ordeal. It takes almost a full day to resolve. And a whole lot of people that died didn't need to die on both sides. One of the key players, one of the heroes in that day, was a Delta Force operator by the name of Norm Hooton. Norm Hooton is a short, 5'9½", blonde-haired, bushy-haired guy that became this incredible kind of the picture for one of the main characters of the movie. He was kind of the baddest dude of the block. Let's put it that way. He was the guy that put his street clothes back on after the 18 hours was over and went back in and got the dead body of the pilot that was left in the street. This cat was serious American. I had the opportunity to train his son one time. It was crazy. He walked into my facility where I was training, and his son, you know, little toehead munchkin, comes in, and I'm like, sir, nice to meet you. And he goes, yeah, I'm Norman Hooton. I had just read the book. I had just watched the movie. I said, you wouldn't happen to be the Norman Hooton from the movie. He was one of the same. I'm like, oh, my God. I felt like I'm in my knees one week. I'm like, I'm meeting an American hero. And he's like, well, depends on who you talk to. I'm like, okay. I'm like, well, I'm not going to really be able to focus today. I'm sorry, because I need to ask you some questions, you know, because I just read the book and I was talking to the kids and everything. He's like, listen, he goes, a lot of stuff was said in that book without having been put out. That's supposed to be classified. I said, okay. He says, but because it isn't, I can start to tell you what I need to know, what I know. I'm like, cool. I'm like, can you tell me anything about that day? He goes, yeah. He goes, I almost died like 5 times. I'm like, okay. I said, well, how did you get out of the situation? He goes, you know what the biggest thing I learned that day there? And I'm in rapt attention. He goes, I learned everything I didn't know about surviving that day from middle school football. I said, really? He goes, yep. He goes, I just had to make sure I had all my gear, and when I got hit, I had to keep going. That's all they ever told me in middle school football. You get hit, pop up, and keep going. Because I had to do things that day were the scariest things I've ever done in my life. He goes, there was one time when I was running into the area where I had to go 100 meters, and everybody that had just gone through the 100 meters had been shot or killed, had been wounded or killed. So it was like military guys laying all over the street. And my commander needed me 100 meters, I had to run 100 meters. And I had 3 guys behind me. They were fathers, brothers, family members in my unit, and we had to go where those guys were. And everybody else that had gone there had been wounded or shot. And there's bullets flying through the streets and RPGs and everything. We got to run. I'm like, what'd you do? He goes, we went. I'm like, how? He goes, there. He goes, you have no idea. He goes, in that moment, your training just kicks in. He goes, I was scared to death. He goes, everybody's peeing themselves. It didn't matter. You just go. And he goes, and we were dipping, dodging, diving, ducking every which way. We happened to make through it. We didn't get shot. I said, well, what'd you do? He goes, I guarded the pilot, the first pilot that died in his helicopter. I guarded his body for 18. I'd be like, that's it? He goes, yep, I sat and guarded the body that was dead for 18 hours. I'm like, nothing else. He goes, well, I said, there was a lot of people that came to that body. I'm like, what do you mean? He goes, I mean, people to kill. He goes, I lost count. He goes, good thing those guys can't shoot because I would have been dead in 10 minutes. He goes, I said, what did you do? He goes, I just had to make sure I could serve them all on purpose. sat there in front of him and just protected him. I'm like, what happened? He says, they finally showed up. The truck would take us out of there. He goes, but there was no room in the truck, so I had to run 2 miles after it was over. I'm like, wait a minute. Hold on a minute. After all that, they didn't give you room for the truck. He goes, there was no room in the truck. He goes, I just ran around the truck for 2 miles. I said, you just fought a battle for 18 hours with very little resources and nobody with you, and you think you had to run to get out? He goes, yeah. I'm like, okay. And then he goes, I said, then what did you do? He goes, well, they still had the dead bodies, you know, the other body of the pilot, so I went back out of that. I am just like in shock, because I'm talking to a guy that was so matter-of-fact about it. It's like you and I are talking about doing our math homework, you know. And I said, well, you got to teach me something, man. Tell me something that would help me tell young men about how to do things better. He goes, well, I'll teach you something. He goes, this R4 thing you're teaching. I said, yeah. He goes, let me show you something that will help you with that. He goes, imagine for a second, because it's my job right now. I train SWAT. I'm like, you what? He goes, yeah, I train SWAT and Federal Air Marshals. I'm like, oh, that's so cool. I'm like, I'm training to teach the guy that's training. He goes, yeah. He goes, SWAT guys are kind of dumb. I'm like, whoa, SWAT guys are dumb. I'm like, okay, explain to me how SWAT guys are dumb. He goes, well, they don't have big egos. He says, you can't have an ego in Delta. You got to figure out problems. These people are smarter than you. They figure out how to do things. Then when they figure it out, you got to figure it out faster than them. You know, because stuff that was done 5 years ago doesn't work today. You have to keep staying on the edge. That's what we did in Delta. He goes, let me give you an example. He goes, imagine there's a guy in the middle of the room who wants to shoot at that door, and we got to kill the guy in the middle of the room. We got to get 4 guys in that room. He goes, who kills the guy in the middle of the room? Which one of the 4 guys are awake at the door? Said, obviously, it's the first guy, because you don't want to put the other guys at risk. He goes, no, 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 that's not how it works. He goes, what we're going to do is we're going to flashbang the guy in the middle of the room. He'll never know him. You ever know what flashbang is? It's that thing that blows up in front of him. It doesn't hurt him. It just disorients him. Then the first guy's going to come in the room, run to the left. And while they're trying to reorient their gun and try to get a shot on him, and he's got body armor on, so nothing's going to, even if he gets hit, it's not going to be superficial. The other guy's already run to the other corner. He goes, the third guy in the room, that guy's already dead. He's not alive. And I'm like, oh. See, in my mind, the whole thing is stopped because there's a guy in the room with his gun pointed at him. The Delta Force operator is already thinking, we got 3 guys in the room before that guy knows what he can hit. I do not want those people coming to my house. Do you understand? But I'm sitting there going, how different the thought process. He was there. Every SWAT guy I tell always gets it wrong. They always think the first guy kills that guy. Because their egos are too big. Because you got to figure out the problem solved, and then you figure out better ways to do things. R4 is about creating opportunities that are made available to you by understanding what you can do. Guys like Delta Force operators have just simply cracked the code of how to do things faster than the defense can recover. And they just make you lose faster. That's all they do. They just outthink you. They outact you. And that's all we're talking about here. If you know what to do, you can move faster than they can. Watch this. Snap the ball, 1, 2, 3, 1.8 foot to the ground, 2.2, that's the hitch, 2.2 again, 2.6, then the ball's out. Now watch this in a real play. What about there? Another one coming from the distance. Bigger one coming.
Kusker to the north. Lights and lighting.
Snap the ball here. This guy right here is in a corner route configuration, okay? He's in a corner route setup. If we're going to throw the rhythm out here, we know this cat's in cover two. The reality is, though, he's over inside and square. He's not in position to take away that route. What I need to know is if he's going to man turn or not. If I know that, that's the speed of my decision. I don't need to read the high-low off the corner or anything. I just simply need to know if that guy is going to man turn. How fast can I know that? So, 3 steps to the receiver, I know that the defender's not in a position to take the play away. When I know what to look for, when I know exactly what I'm after, I know exactly where to throw the ball. Does that make sense? But if I don't know what to look for, I'm not going to be in a position to take advantage of what they're doing. This way, using the terminology of R4, using the language, over, inside, square, when I watch film, I'm able to see what the tendencies are of a defender against different routes. So instead of just watching film and going, oh, they play cover 3, okay, they play cover start taking notes about, okay, he's always over inside the square. He's taking, he does a great job taking away the post, but he's very susceptible to the goalie because he likes to overplay the post or something. Not every defender can play every position very well. You have to every angle very well. So you got to know what they're susceptible to. Some are susceptible to hitch and go. Some are susceptible to they took off too fast. You got to know. Using terminology like this will help you. Snap the ball, he hits the last step, hits the ball. If he held the ball or hitched, the defender would have been in a position to play, take the play away. The key is getting the ball out of the last step of the drop. That's where the advantage is. Let's look at the read route. We know from the last scrimmage that this post route is capped because he's over inside the square. And he's taking it away. This guy is in a better position because he's running a post return. So we have a rhythm and a read route. This kid right here is going to be taken away, but we'll look at it. Why? We have time. How long is it going to take to run the outside route? 2.4 seconds. So we've got time to look at the inside route, draw the attention to the defense, and then reset the throw. The only thing we need to know is for this guy to do what? We need him to what? Zone turn of the post. We need him to turn inside with the post so that he'll be open on the backside. So let's see if he does it. Snap the ball. We confirm the cap here. What does he do? His own turns. Thank you very much. Now that receiver is what? He's open. He's open now. This is where a lot of kids struggle. They hold the ball too long, and they're not in a position to get the ball out quickly enough. And this is where a lot of young men lose their opportunity because they can't see the arrow in the FedEx logo. They can't see the negative space created by the frames of reference of our forward. The rush route is basically the rule list. If you feel the rush, throw the rush. So if you feel an edge pressure, all right, throw the rush route. Those are any routes that break under the hard deck. That is a shallow hitch, seam, bubble, any kind of route that breaks under the hard deck and under 4 yards, that would be a rush route. All this is listed in the material we have, guys. We've got books and DVDs on this. Or it could be the check down or the third option in the play. So here you've got an all play off above the hard deck. This route's tap, each tap comes off and he throws the check down. So rush route properties dictate that we can use it as a rush route or a hot route, or we can use it as a check down. Then of course, if we know that the defense is taking stuff away, we can release. So here we've got that corner route. This route, the corner is tap. But if he's pivoting, he's gonna get collision and he's running the flare. So we can know what to look for here. Snap the ball, the corner route is tap. Okay, see the defender going to go up? Now, the inside guy's getting collision, so we drop off. Now he's going to get capped by this guy, so he's able to run. So in under 3 seconds, he's able to discern who's covered in half. Not because they're standing right next to them, but because they're in the future hallway of the receiver and they know where they're going. What happens a lot of times, guys, do me a favor, going forward, don't bring your cleats on in here, okay? Just please take them off. Please don't wear your cleats inside the building. We're in this situation, we know where we're going. Now he's able to pull the ball down quickly. What ends up happening to a lot of you is you hold the ball too long, the pocket breaks down, you don't get the holes to run away. By then you're pulled down so fast, you're gone. So you've got to learn to make the decision quickly to get out of dodge, because the pocket will break down. Well, I'm not a very fast runner, then you'll never play college football. If you're slow, high school's as high as you go. I'll say that again, it rhymes. If you're slow, high school's as high as you go. They do not take slow quarterbacks to the next level. Period. We gotta be how fast? How fast am I gonna be? Depends on how tall you are. If you're shorter, you gotta be faster. 4'6", 4'5", would be ideal. But if you are 6'3", 6'4", we'll take a 4'7" for it. But you've gotta be athletic. You gotta be able to take a collision and deliver a blow and run the ball. If you're not athletic enough to run the RPO offense and smart enough to do that, that will affect your opportunity. I've seen it happen in many, many cases. We've got to be very careful to pay attention to our ability to run the ball. You don't have to be super fast. You just have to be athletic. And that means putting yourself in a position where you can take advantage of things. All right? Let's show this one last play and we'll figure out where we are.